Ah, what an amazing day. A day of remembrance. I hope your day has been a day of remembrance. And we're going to bump that up a little bit right now. The purpose of all these videos is to help remember who we are. This world is a place of unbelievable forgetfulness, a zone of forgetting who, what we really are. It's incredibly difficult to remember here. Most do not, but it's worth the effort. It will make some difference for you, no question about that. So we make this effort. It's a great effort. Now, it's done in a non-linear fashion. I seem to ramble here, I ramble there, I move this and that, kind of vague, skipping around, not too tightly focused, not so academic, not so linear, all that. That's on purpose, because if it's made linear, A, B, C, 1, 2, 3, like that, the ego has a very easy time defending against that. It can scope out the entire situation and then sidetrack you and throw obstructions, get you lost in details, false hopes. But in this very sort of diffuse, intuitive, non-linear way, the ego doesn't really know what to make of it. The ego's troubled, trips it up, it's not sure how to defend against this. So that's why it's quite effective. Don't be looking for all the dots to line up straight, even though it's possible to certainly do that. You'll find that that may set you back more than you anticipated. So get little bits and pieces here and there, get glimpses. Now, when you look at a landscape, a beautiful landscape, you're taking it all in. You don't say, well, what am I seeing first, and what am I seeing second, what am I seeing third, etc., like that. It's not made up of bits and parts. You don't explain it that way. It's the entirety of what you're seeing. You're seeing it all at once. This is how you have to have insight. This is what insight does. It sees the entirety all at once of a dynamic, or of the interaction of dynamics. It's like you shine a light there and you see the whole picture. You don't delve into, well, first there's this, and then second there's this, and third there's that. That's not real seeing. That's a reporting on what you've seen, but it's not a seeing. Your goal is the seeing, and you will see. It's like an inward vision where you're aware of the whole problem of existence. You can see it. But as soon as you try to explain it with words, it vanishes for you. Because with words, it seems that we're emphasizing something first, right? Well, you say, well, first of all, I see this, and there's that and that. And then the ego will say, oh, so this comes first and this comes second, and puts it into a process mode, like it's a process. Like you're seeing of it was some kind of process that took place. It's not. It's a flash of insight, an intuitive insight, where you see it all at once. And all you can do is encourage others that, yes, it can be seen. Various facets of how we fixate on this, on existence, can be seen. Ultimately, the entire thing can be seen. You can, your seeing can come to that too. But then you try to translate it, and there it vanishes for you. That's why someone like, for instance, Ramana Maharshi, often sit in silence, almost rarely speak at all, just in perfect bliss and peace and silence. When you get into the explaining mode, it seems like it disturbs this silence, because you're looking for a process. And in a process, there's choice, and there's events, and there's problems, and there's possibilities. But in the seamlessness, there's none of that. How is seamlessness a process? You see? So our aim is to get to that seamlessness, which ultimately comes from choosing a new idea. Existence is based on an idea. It's the effects of an idea. Cause and effect. And we can talk about this, but the progress comes from actually seeing it intuitively. You see something intuitively. And that comes from, I say, oftentimes spending a lot of time, blocks of time, till you get to that intuitive seeing, and you will know it. It's different. You'll suddenly say, aha, I see the whole thing as it all works together at the same moment. It's all part of one dynamic. And then you might say, well, how am I going to write a book about this? And then poof, it's gone. And you feel impoverished. Even if you write a book about it, you'll still feel very impoverished compared to seeing the whole dynamic. Now, it's risky doing these videos because I'm speaking using words. And it's difficult because it doesn't really convey the clarity. It's not the clarity itself, it's a commentary on it. Of course I've had great amounts of clarity. Many, many, many times and instances. And I can get that clarity when I make the effort and focus on it. But the commentary here is not the clarity. And yet it's pointing to it. So that's helpful. It's a reminder. We need to remember what we really are. In a place of utter forgetfulness. The very purpose of existence is to forget who we are. So of course we forget when we choose this idea. When we choose another idea, we'll remember who we are perfectly, effortlessly. But because there's no attempt to forget it. It's a testimony to the power we have that we can forget who we are. Not entirely, because we're the one that's doing the forgetting. The forgetting is within us, so we're still there. So the forgetting is not eternal, not forever, because we're the one doing the forgetting, and therefore we can remember also who we are, because we're still present. It's just that we're engaged in forgetting who we are. Now, why are we doing this? Because we, as spirit, call it spirit, it's a good term, we wanted to be on the same level as God, the prime creator. Now, we are not the prime creator. We are the prime created, the first created, the prime created spirit. But we wanted to be on the level of the prime creator. So, how did we go about this? It's not possible to do this, and yet we've tried to do it. Well, basically, if you insist that you're someplace that you're not, someplace other than where you really are, you have to deny where you are. You have to negate where you are. You have to forget where you are. You have to pretend you're not where you are. Otherwise, how can you possibly insist that you're somewhere else? Do you get this? I believe that this is a very good way to see it. Spirit is trying to negate itself. Therefore, here we are in this realm of forgetfulness. We've forgotten who we are. It's an attempt to negate itself. This attempt to say, I am not here. I am somewhere else. I am not what I am. I am something else. This is not my true identity. My true identity is something else. So Spirit has developed this entire scenario, hypothetical scenario of existence, which is an attempt to prove that spirit is not, is really not spirit. It's not where God created it. It's not what God created it to be. Not where God created it to be. Not there at all. So, in the effort to be on the same level as God, the prime creator, spirit has to first deny where it is, already is. Has to try and negate where it already is. So, you should be able to, at some point, intuit this, and see something intuitively, the big broad picture, big horizon, the big landscape, and say, aha, so that's why existence is the way that it is. It's spirit trying to show, prove, give evidence, develop evidence that it's possible to not be what one is. It's possible to not be what spirit is. Spirit's trying to do, to prove this, to generate enough evidence that somehow that this becomes real. Now, what is this evidence? Well, it's death. It's destructivity. Now, one of the central facets of my teaching, the advice and the clarity I am presenting here, is that in order for something to die, something has to be constructed first. This is so important. Otherwise, you will be lost in what I say, in false hope and false optimism about constructivity, not realizing it is just a pawn for destructivity. The purpose of existence is to generate enough evidence so spirit believes it can finally prove that it's not where it really is. Therefore, it must be somewhere else. The way to do this is, of course, by first saying, well, here is something, and then this something is no longer where it was. It's gone. It died. It vanished. Everything in existence, if you look at existence, it vanishes. We should call this cosmos the vanishing cosmos, because that's what it actually is. Ceaseless vanishing. But what is vanishing? Constructs are vanishing. That plant before you is a construct. It's something that's been constructed, right? All of nature is constructing forms. All of these forms are vanishing. And now you know why this is all taking place. Spirit is trying to prove that it can vanish from where it is, which is the prime created. It wants to vanish from there so that it can claim it's somewhere else. How can spirit claim it somewhere else if it still is entirely present where it already is? How can spirit make a claim that it's on the same level as God, the prime creator, if it's God the Son, the prime created? It's there. It's entirely aware of where it is. How can it make the claim it's something else? It's somewhere else. It cannot. So it's somehow spirit is trying to convince itself that it's not where it is. And it uses existence as a tool to try and convince itself that it's not where it already is. And so spirit is simply witnessing all of existence, witnessing all this vanishingness, this destructiviness, this dyingness. And to spirit, this means, aha, you see all of this that I have made, I'm projecting. It shows that there's some kind of power, which is a vanishing power, where everything that seems to be where it is, it vanishes from there. Therefore, spirit says, I too can vanish from where I am. It's possible. So we look, spirit looking at existence, witnessing it, is looking at what's called plausibility. Spirit is saying, ah, see, it's plausible. It is plausible that I can vanish. That's as far as spirit can go with this idea of trying to, I call it, replace reality. Or it's trying to set itself on the throne of reality as the prime creator. That's as far as it can go. It can witness a play of plausibility. But that's it. Nothing more. It never becomes actual. Spirit has no power to change what it is or where it is. Spirit is the prime created from the prime creator. It cannot be on the same level as the prime creator. As far as the direction of creation goes, it's impossible. So spirit cannot vanish itself, cannot vanish from where it is, but it can witness a play of vanishing and fantasize that it's possible. That's all spirit's doing. It's fantasizing. Oh, it's possible. It's possible. It's plausible. It's possible. It's plausible. That's all spirit's getting out of existence, is that it's plausible. But it's spirit that's simply doing all this pretending, like a puppet show. Existence is a puppet show. The constructive spirit is causing all this constructivity arise so that it can all vanish. And then it feels like, ah, I'm vanishing, I'm vanishing, it's possible to vanish. And yet spirit's still entirely aware of all this vanishing. It's still exactly where it's always been. And it can't get rid of this, and it's frustrated over the whole thing. So, there you go. There, in a nutshell, is a way to look at existence, the entire situation. And when you get an intuitive glimpse of this, you'll feel it, and you'll see it, and you say, aha. And that's remembering. That is remembering. And then you'll try to say, well, how can I explain this to someone else? And then, poof, it's gone. And you don't have to make existence a super complicated situation if you look at it this way. If you look at it as the prime purpose, what's the purpose of it? You see the purpose of it first, then you don't even have to try and figure anything else out. Because it's all a puppet show. For a futile purpose. So what is there to figure out? Nothing. That simplifies. Existence isn't some vast mystery anymore, really. You become very disinterested in it. But you become very interested in choosing a new idea, choosing another idea. The idea of trying to place oneself on the throne of creation is nothing but a situation of watching vanishing take place and believing that this is plausible. That's no fun. Boring. It's misery. All this vanishing is such folly. That's why it's possible. The deathless realm is possible. The experience for spirit. Because all death comes from just this one idea of trying to prove that vanishing is possible. That's where it comes from. So now you have the mystery of death has been resolved for you forever. You say, okay, ho-hum, that's fine, but let's get on to choosing a new idea. How do we do that? See, that's the real, that is the real goal. Clarification just helps move one towards the real goal. But when you see everything intuitively for what it really is, existence, then existence doesn't become, so mysterious for you. It's kind of like the jig is up and like, why spend any more time trying to figure all this out? I've already figured it out. It doesn't even need to be figured out because it's so simple. But we need to remember what we are and what idea we chose. What we tried to do. And we don't need to personify it and say, well, there's some Lucifer, you know, an angel misled everybody or such and such. that personifies everything, but it's really beyond personification. It's abstract, it's basic, it's factual. It's simply spirit chosen idea of wanting to see what it would be like to be prime creator. Now it could be, you could say that facets of spirit, spirit has infinite facets, and some facets chose that and other led other facets to try and experience that too. That's very possible. But don't get stuck on that. It's not very important. It's much more important to see what existence really is. And don't be fooled by the constructive. That's the most misleading of all. You hear, oh, it's possible to do so much beautiful constructivity, etc. Fine, that's, of course there's tinges of beauty. We can do that, but it's only for the purpose of destructivity, so vanishing can take place. You know, there's like a picture I saw of total destructivity, and the goddess was dancing, and she's so happy. Why? Because she says, oh, look at all the vanishing that took place there. That means that I, too, have vanished from where I am, and now I am on the throne of God. I am equal with God. In fact, I'm on the same level, so I created myself, and maybe even I created God. Who's to say? So she's deliriously euphoric, looking at all the destructivity. It's like that. That represents our spirit. That's what spirit is actually looking for. Spirit is looking for destructivity to prove that it can be equal to God the Prime Creator. It can be God the Prime Creator because it's been able to vanish from what it was. It's no longer what it was. What it was is gone. You see, that's so we symbolize spirit. Spirit symbolizes itself in constructs, constructivity. It calls this life. All this interactivity of constructs. It says this is life, this is identity, this is reality, and then it destroys it all, and then it looks and says, aha, you see, I am no longer what I was. What I was is vanished, it's gone, it's no more. That means I must be something else. I'm no longer what I was. I'm no longer where I was. It's all vanished. So the so-called good goddess, the goddess of constructivity, she constantly sings a song to us of constructivity. Beautiful ornamentation and dance and sweet harmony and saying, come on, construct, construct, construct. And she's so pleased with the constructivity, like you're doing God's work. But the fact is, you are simply setting the stage for destructivity. And then destructivity comes in, destroys it all, and then dances on the flames, saying, look, you see, it is possible that I can vanish from where I am. Spirit can say, the life that I was created with is no more, you see. I'm freed, therefore it is possible I'm something else now, because what I was is gone. It's negated. So it becomes possible then to assert that spirit is something else. But if spirit is exactly what it's always been, how can it assert it's something else? And where in reality does spirit get any evidence that it can be something else? It has to invent this dream of negation, which is existence, and then witness this dream of negation to believe it's possible that it can negate itself and therefore be something else, something else, something different. And the waking up is simply to see this. see that this is the way that it is. This is what's taking place here. Very difficult to deny this. Once you see it, you know, you'll say, oh, of course. How come I didn't see that before? Because the very purpose of this idea is to continue on with this effort of constructivity and destructivity. If you see it, you won't be so enthusiastic about continuing on with this. You'll say, well, it's a waste of time. It gets nowhere. Why be super constructive when you know you're just being a pawn for the destructivity? You know that vanishing will come for whatever constructs you make. It doesn't matter what. The tide of vanishing, it's like the tide comes in and washes all the sandcastles away. Doesn't matter what the form the sandcastle takes. You can make a very elaborate forms. You can make a sandcastle that looks like a world, and you think, well, my sandcastle is a world, therefore it cannot be washed away. Do you think the ocean cares what form the sandcastle takes? The ocean doesn't care at all. The wave comes in and all the different sandcastles on that beach, no matter what they were of, no matter what form they took, they all equally wash away. So it doesn't matter what form constructivity takes. Path of clarification is to see the entire picture for what it is, the totality of it, not to try and be a booster for constructivity, neither a booster for destructivity. Because destructivity, of course, is trying to prove that spirit isn't spirit, which is ridiculous. But in reality, spirit has no need for constructs. Constructs are just made out of dream stuff made out of dust. They're not eternal. They're just concepts. They're symbols. They're constructs. Spirit has no need of those in reality. So we should not make a god of constructs. We should not emphasize the positive. Spiritual path does not emphasize the positive nor the negative, but to see both of them as one two-faced dynamic. It's one actual dynamic, because destructivity has to have constructs first. It's very important to see this, that destructivity cannot come first, can it? You can't have destructivity first and then constructivity, because how can you say destructivity if nothing is destroyed? It's a completely empty concept, isn't it? So in order to even speak of destructivity, you must be speaking of something was there, which is then no longer there. It's been destroyed. What it was has vanished, so to speak. Even if you have a building and it collapses into a million fragments, the building, what it was, has vanished. It's no longer what it was. It's what it was seems to have vanished. There you have the purpose of existence. But in order for that building to vanish, you had to first produce the building, construct it. It's a beautiful evening tonight. People are walking along the street. And yet everything that we see, everything that's taking place here, will one day vanish as well. We all know that. And yet we never put two and two together until now. Certainly in other times and places, two and two has been putting together also. But this is our time and place. We have to do it now. Doesn't matter if someone did it thousands of years ago. It's nice to know. But the problem is that we look at these constructs. We look at the world around us and what we have constructed, and we assume that somehow this is different than thousands of years ago. That's the problem. So we really don't believe in whatever happened thousands of years ago. We really don't believe it because we say, you know what? We have made constructs that are so much better. But in the back of our minds, deep down, what we're really saying is that the vanishing of these constructs will really prove that it is possible for what we are, spirit, to vanish from where it is. That is what we really believe in. All these skyscrapers you see and bridges, the superstructure of the modern world, what we really have faith in is that the destructivity of all of this will prove that it's that we can vanish from where we really are, that nothing is eternal, nothing is where it's placed is eternally placed there, that spirit we can negate where we are, where we've been placed, we can vanish from there. No trace. That means we must be somewhere else, and then we can assert that we are prime creators. So that's the arrogance of the time. But really, the world is arrogant right now. Because it says, aha, you know what? This destructivity that's going to take place is really going to be the effective one. This vanishing is really going to prove once and for all some kind of principle of being able to negate what we are and where we are. And of course, if you understand what's being said here, you know that's absolute folly. So that we don't have, there's not arrogance here about the modern world. Like its collapse is going to prove anything. Certainly it will collapse. Certainly destructivity is coming. Which is why everyone here has the feeling that they do. Like, you know, wow, something great is going to happen. We're right on the verge of ascension. We're right on the cusp of a new consciousness, all of this stuff. But deep down, it's because we believe that the destructivity is going to prove that it's possible that we are not what we really are, that we've somehow vanished from that. We've negated, spirit has negated its position in reality. It's no longer there. We believe this will prove it. But the question is, prove it to who? Will this prove it to God, the prime creator? That where the prime creator placed the prime created is no longer there? I tell you, will not prove it at all to God the prime creator. None of this has any effect whatsoever. There's one thing that God the prime creator cannot do. God the prime creator cannot destroy itself. Cannot destroy its creation. Creation is itself. Cannot destroy it. So everything is the way that it is. The way that it's been created cannot be changed or altered, cannot vanish. So everyone who is feeling optimistic right now, what is that optimism really about? What it's really about is believing that it's possible to create something that seems so strong and vital and full of life so that its vanishing will give proof that something so perfectly vital and alive as spirit can also vanish. That's where it's really coming from. This is the greatest, deepest secret of existence. You see this, you know that you are going to be free from all this folly because you will no longer be seduced into this constructivity because underneath it, the purpose is really a destructive purpose. Nobody wants to admit that. Because the stakes seem so high, because we believe if we can prove that there's some principle of vanishing or negation, that means we can be prime creators, and we think that this will be some kind of incredible experience for us, that we will be fulfilled beyond anything possible, you know. So we feel that the payoff is so great that we're willing to keep putting up with all of this. We're willing to be seduced into more constructivity, knowing deep down inside it's all for the purpose of being destroyed and washed away. We're building sandcastles on the beach one more time, more and more elaborate. We're building skyscraper sandcastles so that when the wave comes in and washes it away, we can say, wow, look at the power of the wave. The wave is all powerful. It can wash away reality itself. Because if it can wash away the skyscraper sandcastle, surely the wave can wash away spirit as well. So it's no longer what it is. That's our folly. And then we zoom ahead into the future. And once again, we see ourselves on the beach building sandcastles, different type of sandcastles. And we talk to our future selves and we ask them, what are you doing? You know, what are you doing? They say, we're building these incredible structures here that'll be forever here. This is the most amazing civilization ever. I said, and we'll ask, did you remember the last one you did? Those skyscraper sandcastles, what happened to them? We don't think about that. We've forgotten all that. I don't know. We're involved with this now. We're building this great civilization. This will be eternal civilization. You know. And then another wave comes in, washes that away. And on and on that goes. Until you finally wise up. But you can wise up right now, because what's happening now is what's always been happening. Nothing different. So it's possible to see it all right now. Very possible. Certainly you can glimpse it. And if you glimpse it, you're not going to spend, vast amounts of time continuing to be suckered into this whole process. This whole dance of delusion. Dance of false hope. Of folly. Building sandcastles, claiming that they're eternal and watching them wash away, and then claiming, there's some power that can wash away eternity, that can wash away reality, actuality, and then finding out that it doesn't, you're still spirit, exactly what you've always been, and then you try and build something else, construct something else so it can be washed away again. That's what we've been doing for so long, believing in what we've constructed so much, putting our heart and soul, we want to project spirit into everything so that when it washes away, we feel that our very spirit has been washed away. That's why we always say, don't be too attached to the world, to this construct here. Overcome your valuing of the world. Don't be attached to it. Don't put your spirit into it, because you're doing that for the purpose of when it washes away, you want to feel that it proves that your spirit can be washed away. Your spirit has been washed away. It's no longer what it was, once was. It's gone. That's why people get attachments here in this world, very, very attached. And then when they lose what they're attached to, they feel this, incredible devastation. And they're trying to feel, this is how it feels, that I'm no longer what I used to be. What I used to be is gone. My spirit is gone. This is suffering. Spirit is constantly suffering, trying to prove some kind of power of negation. And eventually it realizes that's not enough and it's still spirit, and then it attaches to something else and does it again. Until it wises up. It's very possible spirit can wise up right now. Spirit is still entirely intact. All these dreams of its negation are just fantasies. Spirit is still exactly what it's always been, exactly where it's always been. Same functionality, same capacity to experience any and all ideas. It's the great adventurer, the great chooser, the great presenter, great experiencer. Nothing has been damaged. Spirit believes that it's been able to negate itself, at least to a large extent. So it believes it's been damaged, that it's mostly been negated. because it believes in this dream that it's witnessing to. So it believes that, you know, it cannot experience itself fully or wholly anymore. That has to try and experience bits and pieces of itself, which is why it seeks for relationships in form, like this thing, this person, like these are all bits and pieces of a fragmented spirit. The spirit cannot experience itself directly wholly anymore because it's been negated and fragmented. So the only way it can experience itself is through all these inner complex interweaving social relationships, a piece of spirit here, a piece of spirit there, a piece of spirit there, linking them together, you know. That's why the social network sites are so important to people, so they can feel they're connecting with other parts of spirit. It's all based on the belief in negation. It's possible to negate. Spirit saying, well, I'm no longer what I used to be. Now I'm at the very best, I'm all these fragments. So the only way I can experience myself is through all this fragmentation, interaction, and eventually all this will get negated too. So meanwhile, it interacts socially in all these complex ways. But the fact is, spirit has never been negated. There's no power of negation. It's completely whole. It's completely intact. There doesn't have to be any journey of networking back to spirit, back to wholeness. Spirit already is whole right now. It's always been. Negation has never done anything to spirit. You don't need to be interacting with any construct in order to realize this. You can be in a cave if you want to. Doesn't matter. Or you can be interacting if you want to, too. Doesn't matter either way. Doesn't make any difference. The fact is, spirit is completely whole, completely intact, exactly as it was created. None of this negation of form has had any effect on spirit whatsoever. None of it. Not even the tiniest bit. So you don't need to go seeking around the world, collecting pieces of your spirit, trying to put them together like Humpty Dumpty. That's a waste of time. It might seem fun for a while, like, hey, look what I'm doing. I'm putting spirit back together. Wow, I'm going to reassemble my wholeness. It's ridiculous. Your wholeness is already perfectly there. It's never been fragmented. And I trust that you get something out of these longer talks like this. It's helpful to have a time where everything is emphasized and re-emphasized and approached from slightly different angles, reapproached and reapproached like this. So you'll give yourself an opportunity. You never know when something will ignite an intuitive glimpse of the wholeness of the situation, the actualness of the situation. It only takes a brief burst of light to see the landscape around you in the night, right? The light flashes on, you see everything, and then it's gone. But at least you know, aha, there really is a landscape out there. I saw it all, for sure. Now, how to get this light on permanently? In the listening to this again and again and again, we keep returning to playing the various themes. It's like playing a concerto. There's various themes that are woven through the piece again and again and again. We return to them. Familiarity in a slightly different variations. It's like that. And until the theme becomes familiar. Because again, we live in this place of forgetfulness. Total forgetfulness. We're trying to negate what we are. We're focusing on vanishing and losing. Losing everything. Everything slipping through our fingers. And there's a part of us that is dancing in abandoned, wild glee, you know, great glee, and look at all this destructivity. Isn't this great? This proving my point. You know, there's something inside you that's so amazingly exultant over all this that's happening in the world. It's saying, you see, there is some power of negation. I'm proving it, I'm proving it, I'm proving it. I can negate what I am, and I can be something different. There is that facet, there is that dynamic. The goddess raises all the children, and then she destroys all of them, and then dances with, you know, wild abandon and glee over saying, look, look. Look at the power of negation. Isn't this fantastic? You see, life can be destroyed. I can negate, spirit can be negated. That means I can be prime creator. There's something in us that is drunk on destructivity. Really. Totally drunk on it. And if you admit that and you see it, that's part of the dynamic of existence. That's the actual dynamic of existence. We're all drunk on the wine of destructivity, even though for a time we are compulsively fascinated with constructivity. We raise the beautiful flowers, and then the winter comes, and oh, all the flowers are gone. Oh, how terrible to see them all wiped out there by the frost. But we put so much effort into planting all those flowers. And now we're looking at them, they're all gone. And there's something in us that is sort of exulting in that. That there's some sort of quiet, subtle satisfaction, like, ah, good job. Good job, you see, we were able to produce some negation there. Couldn't have done it without you. You know, there's something saying that to the constructive part, saying, ah, I couldn't have done it without you. Good job. Something whispering, have babies, have babies. Have more and more children, more children, more children. Say, oh, great job, because then they all die eventually. And something says, oh, really good job. Great job to constructivity. Constructivity is always getting patted on the back by destructivity. Destructivity is saying, oh, you're doing a great job. Keep it up, keep it up. Wonderful. You're really producing all these forms so that they can be destroyed, so I can prove that vanishing is possible, negation is possible. And that explains the strange dichotomy we have within. We seem conflicted, you know, the good and the bad. We seem to be the angel and the devil, you know, one on each shoulder. That explains it all. It's no longer a mystery. We have been flailing away at this, trying to understand what's going on for so long, come up with so many bizarre explanations, bits and pieces, fragments here and there, have not been able to put the entire thing together. Not very often. Doesn't happen very often. It requires a dedication to doing it, a single-minded dedication to doing just that, putting it all together. But it is possible. It's very simple, actually. It's right there in front of us, unequivocally obvious. We don't need all the other explanations anymore. They're just useless. It's like once the sun rises, you don't need a flashlight anymore. You don't need to have that flashlight, because you can see everything. Once the obviousness of it all becomes apparent, you don't need to try and figure everything out in arcane and strange, bizarre, labyrinthine ways, if that's a word, I don't know. Maybe labyrinthian ways, I don't know, but going through a maze, so many different mazes, and we think, oh, okay, we're getting somewhere here, going down this corridor, going down that way. now we see it very simply for what it is. Don't need all those other tortured exercises of trying to grab a little piece of it here and there and try to understand it from this little piece, fragment. See the whole picture. You don't need to weave fragments together. Try to glue them together, you know. You get some odd configurations that way. Really, there's so many. There's a vast, vast swamp of odd configurations of trying to do partial explanations. Still trying to leave some mystery, some darkness, some obscurity intact. You get tortured, strange explanations because they're still defending against seeing the entirety of it. When you see the entirety of it, it's so simple and clear. And so many don't want to do that yet. Why? Because the payoff, they say, I don't want to see what's going on because as long as if I just keep deluding myself enough, I believe it'll become real delusion and I can negate myself, negate spirit. So here we are, we're thinking, oh, I'm a body, I'm a person in the world. Knowing full well that this body, this person is going to die, going to be destructed, is going to vanish. And we think, I did a good job. Pat myself on the back. Spent another life adding to the reservoir of proof and negation. That's really what's taking place. And of course, silly notion that, well, if we wake up and see what's going on, then they'll want to die is ridiculous. Why, if we see that the purpose is negation and to prove negation, the negation is impossible, why would we want to die? Why would we want to add more proof to it? We wouldn't. We don't have any such motives at all. It's ludicrous. You'd realize it doesn't make any difference one way or the other. No such thing as negation. You cannot negate reality. You can dream of constructs, symbols, and negate those symbols, have those symbols seem to transform into something else, vanish. But that's not actuality at all. The fog is coming in here. Very nice. Very cool this evening. Recently it's been very clear, and now the fog has come in. That's the way the world works, right? You go through a period of constructivity and everything seems to be, wow, we're really building the great society here. And then the fog comes in and the darkness comes in and everything begins to rot and decay. We're going through that period right now. Globally. Especially though in some places like the United States and modern countries that have really been on the peak of constructivity and are now starting to rot and decay. The dream is vanishing, the luster is off the bloom is off the rose. The luster is very dim now because the fog has come in and it'll get deeper and denser and colder and chillier until everything just begins to rot and decay very quickly. Same old cycles of existence at play. But it's really no fun. I mean, I don't take any joy out of it. Sure, the dynamic in this dream is that there's a part that is exulting in all of this, you know. That is trying to tell you, hey, you know, this is really for your own benefit. This is a great thing. This is simply opening the doors for some cosmic ascension. This is just burning off your karma. This is just clearing out the debris so you can see and be set free. And there's so many things like that, you know. There's that which is saying all of that because there's that which believes that all this destruction is going to prove that it, the power of negation, so it's so excited about that, really. And of course, that part, that dynamic is speaking to all of us and saying, listen to me, listen to me. We're on the brink of something really, really great. And so, of course, it speaks to me, and I keep saying, no, 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 that's not true. That's not true. It speaks to everyone. That inner voice is speaking to everyone, saying, you know, trying to prop everything up, saying, yeah, this is exactly the way everything's supposed to be. God is working flawlessly, and you will see, you know, how unbelievably great the future will be. We just have to destroy everything here first, and then we'll get the greatness will come after that. But now we see what's really taking place. There won't be greatness coming after. There will simply be another round of constructivity as we realize that the greatness did not come. The negation did not come. We were not able to negate ourselves. Therefore, not able to be prime creators. And if that's our purpose, to be prime creator, we will remain frustrated. This idea doesn't satisfy us. So what do? We choose a new idea. How about choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator? Not trying to negate what we are, where we are. Not trying to change our place in creation. Not trying to replace reality with a new reality, a new way, a new structure of creation, of reality. Let's try the idea of not trying to do this. Accepting where we are. Let's try the idea, I accept where I am in creation. I accept that I'm spirit. The prime created. How about that idea? Then there's no need to prove any power of negation at all. There's no reason to raise up constructs so that they can be deconstructed. No reason for any death. No reason for any dying. No reason to see anything that's dying or dead or vanishing. No reason to see any vanishing at all. Which means you can dwell in what's called the deathless realm. There's not a trace of vanishing there whatsoever. That is very, very possible. All you have to do is choose this new idea. The idea, I'm not trying to change what I am, where I am, my place. I'm not trying to negate what I am. Choose that idea. The idea of not trying to replace reality with a new reality. Not trying to place ourselves on the throne as prime creator. The idea of accepting exactly what we are and where we are as spirit. And that will lead to the deathless realm, where there's no trace of any vanishing, nothing's vanishing. Constructs can still be there, because we're experiencing that we're not trying. Therefore, the constructs give evidence, the deathlessness of the constructs give evidence that we are not trying to negate anything. You see, there has to be constructs there so that you can point to the constructs and see and say, you see, there is no effort to negate any of this that proves that I am exactly what I am. Now, this proof is only necessary because we tried to prove that we could negate ourselves. And so we're kind of, this is like the cure. Now, if we never chose that idea in the first place of negating ourselves, we wouldn't need a cure for that. So we wouldn't need to have any constructs at all that we're looking at. But because we did choose the idea of trying to negate ourselves, it's the best way to go about it is to choose the cure for that, which is to see the constructs and realize and there's no vanishing, no negating of them. And then we'll see, aha, you see, I'm not trying to negate where I am, what I am. There is a deathless realm. There actually, that's the effects of this new idea. Where everything is pristine and immaculate, and nothing is vanishing. Nothing is sick. Nothing is deteriorating. No sign of deterioration. No sign of negation. Exquisite. We can choose that instead of the idea of negation. That's the only choice we really have right now. The only meaningful choice. We do have a choice. We could choose some other idea altogether. But for practical purposes, we'll keep it right here in what the remedy is, really. But the practical remedy is so we have continuity. Don't need to have the universe vanish. All the constructs that we're familiar with can remain, but we can have the vision of everything being immaculate and no need, and no sign of deterioration anywhere. We can also have everything blanketed by a seamlessness, and have that seamlessness be completely unaffected by any deterioration that's taking place. That's another way to go about it, too. It's just a variation. We can have that first, and then the deathless realm is eventually our destiny. And this is real talk. This is real destiny. It's either that, or you continue to experience negation, evidence of negation, of destructivity. Those are the two options. So once you see what your options are, everything comes into focus for you. Some will want to watch the goddess dance on the corpse of this world and watch her exultation as she dances and saying, look at this, I'm so liberated, I'm so free now, look at the I'm empowered by the evidence of negation, I've become a new being, I've transcended my beingness. I'm now prime creator, prime creatress. By dancing on all the corpses here. There's some that there's an inducement to that because you look at the goddess, she's so exalted, feeling like she's so deliriously happy. There are many in this world that will feel so incredibly empowered by all of this. And you'll be, in shock and awe of their sense of empowerment. And you'll wonder, wow, is this really it? Maybe this empowerment is the real deal. And we don't want to miss this empowerment. There are some that have come to dance. As the destructivity takes place here, they will dance in joy. And you think, wow, maybe I shouldn't miss all this because maybe this is the empowerment. But it's not. They're drunk on the wine of destructivity. It's a drunkenness. It's not actual bliss. It's not spirit accepting spirit as it is. It's severe drunken euphoria on the false belief that negation has proven itself to have some actual power. So you don't need to stay and witness all this and pay attention to it. It's not true empowerment. It's an attempt at disempowerment, which is futile. We could go on and on and on. We're touching on some very powerful themes here. I've had amazing responses from all different angles on my videos. And, across the board, there are some who literally are just chomping at the bit for the destructivity to take place, and they just can't wait. And they're so, just enraptured by the destructivity to come, and all the killing and the corpses, and they're feeling that's going to empower them. Be a new being. So that's real. That there are many in the world here of that persuasion, of that belief, a very powerful belief. We all have some belief in that. Otherwise, we discard this idea this instant. I'm no different than anyone else as far as there is there is some attraction to that. There has to be, or else we would discard it immediately. If there was zero attraction to it, we would choose a new idea immediately. So we all have some attraction. The issue is, can we thin that attraction out to the point where we don't need to remain fixated and remain here and watch these lunatics, you know, exult in the destruction? The lunacy here will be extreme. The madness. People will become absolutely mad about the destructivity of it all. And the constructors will also go insane just from the shock of it all. They'll just kind of crumble. You don't have to do either one of those. You don't have to crumble in shock about over the destructivity. You don't have to be in awe of the madness of the destructive dance of destructivity, the exultation over it, the belief that somehow this proves negation. You don't have to participate in any of that. You can be detached. You can realize this is just a stupid high school play, you know. And you don't have to watch it. So what am I doing here watching this stupid play? Let's do something else here. Let's be aware of options. The deathless realm is an option. Somehow that is an option. So we stay aware of options. We keep clarifying what's actually happening here and reminding ourselves that we will have a little bit of attraction to watching the destructivity and watching those who pretend to be empowered by this destructivity. Those are the ones who will take the stage. They're waiting in the wings. You know, you're watching a play, and those actors and actresses who are about to come onto the stage are waiting in the wings for their cue. When they get their cue, on they come to the stage, you know, reveling and jousting and shouting and dancing and all of this. And you say, here come the new wave of actors and actresses. Here they are. You don't have to watch this play. You don't have to watch them because you know what they're about. They're celebrating the so-called power of destructivity, the power of negation. They're exulting in it. They're acting as if this has somehow turned them into prime creators. They've been elevated into another, you know, a higher realm because they've proven that what they were is no more. There's a tendency to want to watch that. We all have that tendency to say, well, I wonder if this is really, you know, something, maybe. I don't want to miss this exaltation, you know. I don't want to miss being ascended into a higher state. I don't want to miss out on that. Maybe if I go to the deathless realm, I will miss out on all of this. And I'll miss out on something greater than that. So, but now in hearing this video, listening to these videos that are being produced and presented here, you're seeing what's really taking place. So you're sobering up. You won't be entirely sober. Okay, that's important to know. Cut yourself some slack. Don't get fooled thinking that you're dead. Somehow you have to be totally sober in order to make the right decisions, good decisions. Choose the right options for you. It's not possible to be entirely sober and still be considering these things. If you were entirely sober, you would literally choose a new idea this very instant. And since we haven't done that, most have not, that means we're still not entirely sober, still have tendencies to believe that its negation is possible. And since we believe that maybe negation is possible, we have to search for evidence of it. We're still attracted to the evidentiary play to a certain extent. So we need to remind ourselves over and over again, this isn't it. This is a waste of time. This doesn't lead to a higher state. It may lead to more sophisticated and complex constructions, but that's only for the purpose of them also being destroyed. And it's a waste of time. It's folly. It's futility. It's misery, it's suffering, it's death, it's decay, it's decline, it's despair, it's everything that we've been experiencing recently here in this world. Tremendous decline and despair and suffering and misery and depression. We don't have to keep pushing through with that. Let those who want to do that, let them do that. Let them dance. Don't try to stop them from dancing, because you won't succeed. Because they're mad for the dance. Really mad for it. They want to shake their hair loose and tear their clothes and scream and rant and rave and go crazy. Celebrating the dance of destruction. Let them do it. Don't try to get in their way. Just you sidestep it all. Get into the mood of sidestepping it. Me, when I drive past an accident in the road, I don't even look at it. Peripherally, I say, okay, there's something up ahead. Everybody's rubbernecking. Ah, there's the fire trucks and the paramedics and a bunch of cars. So obviously, there's you know, been a commotion, some trouble. But why do you have to study it? Just drive past. Don't even look at it. Don't focus on it. Say, okay, whatever. It is what it is. But stay on the road. Keep your focus on the road. Drive. You can sidestep it like that. You know there's going to be commotion here. You don't have to focus on it. You don't have to be part of it. You don't have to participate in it. You don't have to give evidence for negation. You don't have to die. You don't have to be destroyed. You don't have to be pulled down into the muck and the mire and vanish. Because you know it's all foolish, folly, useless, waste of time, of no value whatsoever, completely meaningless to reality. It only feeds a belief system that is futile. There is no power of negation. Your death is not going to empower negation, because there is no power of negation. Zero. So you're feeding nothing. You're scattering like seed on concrete. It's not going to grow. It's a waste. Your death is a waste. Your suffering is a waste. It accomplishes nothing. It doesn't matter what the goddess might tell you. How you're some kind of hero. Don't be a hero of the dream. Heroes, their destiny is to die. Heroes of the dream, that's their destiny. Death is their destiny. Siren song sings to them, luring them to their destruction. You don't have to be that hero. You don't have to be that one. Not at all. Give up your hero status, because it's a zero status. Because heroes get zeroed out. So the goddess of destruction can dance on their grave and shriek about, you see, I am now the prime creator, because look, what was once spirit has now been destroyed, is gone, is vanished. That means I have ascended into a higher condition. That's what heroes are used for. Cannon fodder. Forget about it. Don't think you're letting down the dream. How can you let down nothing? How can you let down the impossible? What are you letting down? Someone says, well, I didn't accomplish the impossible because you didn't help me accomplish the impossible. What kind of meaning is that? It's meaningless. So don't let the judgment of the meaninglessness sway you. Don't let meaningless be your judge. This idea, this dream, this scenario of possibility is meaningless. Don't let it judge you. Don't let it say that that it's failing because you're not a hero. You're not a sacrificial hero of the dream. That's lots of lie. It's failing because it can never be true in the first place. If a goddess wants to go into a pout, let her pout. Who cares? It's all just a theatrics anyway, antics. It's just spirit trying to accomplish the impossible, trying to negate itself, using these marketing devices, these tactics, to try and keep the assembly, the sacrificial assembly line, flowing smoothly. Get out of that assembly line. Don't be part of it anymore. You don't have to be. That is for sure. Because everyone will eventually get out of that assembly line, realizing the complete ludicrous folly of it all. So when that recruiter comes to you and tries to recruit you to be a hero, say, forget it. I don't want to be a zero anymore. I'm moving along. I'm choosing a new idea. I'm headed for the deathless realm. I'm getting free of negation. No more negation for me. No more vanishing. I am what I am. I am what God created me to be. And that's it. Very great. That's it.